I have a great honor to be here and to introduce you myself. I have a need to do so, as last 14 years I was unfortunately totally abstained from any direct activity in the field of archaeology. Due to the fact that I work all these years in the Georgian Institute of History and Ethnology, and no more in the Georgian Center of Archaeological Studies. Nevertheless, the archaeology occupied and still occupies an important part of the scope of my scientific vision. Already at the end of the 70s, I tried to propose a higher absolute dates for the Kuro-Araxes culture of Georgia and generally of Transcaucasia, not only on the basis of calibrated radiocarbon dates, but as well and perhaps mainly by the data of relative chronology of this culture spreading throughout the Near East. Extremely favorable circumstance from the point of view of chronological studies. I have had in mind the fact that the Transcaucasian origin of the Kuro-Araxes culture and its later spread to the Middle East, where archaeological strata were more accurately dated than in Transcaucasia. These circumstances were giving us a favorable opportunity to determine the starting date of the culture in Transcaucasia. At the time, such conclusion was mainly obtained according to the data of Western Iranian archaeological sites, Göztepe, Godin, Tepe, and so on. The dating of the first obvious signs of the Kuro-Araxes culture found in situ in the layers of local cultures of the Middle East represented the terminus antequem for similar and antedating archaeological artifacts of Trocasian Kuro-Araxes culture. The dates obtained for the archaeological material of the Kuro-Araxes origin detected in the Near Eastern cultural layers by correlation with the evidence of historical sources of Mesopotamia and Egypt constitute an important argument per se to demonstrate the necessity of considerably shifting back of the accepted dating of the Transcaucasian Kuro-Araxes culture, as the latter belongs to the period earlier than the Near Eastern Kuro-Araxes materials. Therefore, this could be done even without using the celebrated radiocarbon dates. Quite logical question arises. What innovations have been obtained during the past time in the absolute and relative chronology of the Near East and Transcaucasia, and as well in the sphere of the chronological interrelations of archaeological materials of both these regions? First of all, we have now a much wider set of the dates received by the radiocarbon technique. Secondly, new indications of the overlapping in time of the Kuro-Araxes and Uruk cultures, which have been revealed in last years with much more intensity than earlier, poses not only the problem of relation between these cultures, but gives possibility to reconsider the character of cultural and social developments between the highly civilized societies of the core area of the Near East and the northern frontier, and the regions located beyond of the latter. It is quite obvious that the term Kuro-Araxes culture is not quite right. It has not a strict territorial meaning, but some symbolic one, indicating on the area where the culture was first discovered. This culture covers a much larger area than the land between the two rivers in Transcaucasia, the Kura and the Araxes. Indeed, it covers an important part of the Middle East, that is, eastern Anatolia, the Levant, the northwestern Iran. However, Transcaucasia is generally accepted to represent the core area of the initial formation of the Kuro-Araxes culture. One of the most important aims for the archaeologists working on problems of the northern frontier of Near Eastern archaeology and basing themselves on the recent researches in Transcaucasia and Eastern Anatolia of the late Chalcolithic early Bronze Age is to elaborate a common periodization and chronological construction for establishing the links between the cultural and social developments in different regions of the Near East within the context of the Uruk cultural phenomenon. The overview of evidence from chronologically relevant layers containing some archaeological signs of the Koro Araxes culture allows us to put the starting date of this culture in Transcaucasia somewhere during the Middle Uruk period at least. In the middle and the second half of the fourth millennium, nearly simultaneously on the northern periphery of the Middle East, the activity of the Uruk colonists and the bearers of the Koro Araxes culture can be traced. This remarkable phenomenon took place in the northwestern part of the Middle East in the late Uruk period. The destruction of the sites were revealed the trace typical of late Uruk period by the Koro Araxes population of northern origin. It seemed that economical importance of the late Uruk enclaves and outposts such as Aslan Tepe 6, Hasekuyuk 5, Habuba Kabira Telkanas, Jebel Aruda Tepecik 3, as well as Ogodin 5 in western central Iran, attracted the attention of these invaders, characterized by the red-black handmade burnished pottery, the high arsenic copper metallurgy and certain types of metal artifacts, the wattle and daub houses, and the particular type of hearse. The intrusive character of the Koro Araxes culture in the area became obvious after the exposure of the stratigraphical sequence documented at Aslan Tepe, where level 6B1 containing the material of the culture mentioned interrupted the preceding level 6A and following development level 6B second of local horizons. But earlier, already during Aslan Tepe 7 layer, there were found shares of the red-black handmade but of the high technological level burnished pottery, supposedly of the Koro Araxes origin. They appear gradually at Aslan Tepe in period 7, overlapping with chef-faced half of red-slipped ores that are generally linked to the northern Syrian Mesopotamian environment. In the opinion of Frangipane, this finding clearly points to the fact that even at the end of period 7, in Aslan Tepe, local population was in contact with the communities of the Koro Araxes cultural traditions. The circumstance which permits us to propose the existence of the bearers of the latter tradition over the other time, that means during the Middle Uruk period. At the time, we should have in mind the fact that the red-black type pottery of the Koro Araxes culture is a sign not of earlier, but of the development stage of this culture. Consequently, I felt that there was a rather high probability to shift the initial date of the Koro Araxes culture of Transcaucasia somewhere in the first half of the fourth millennium, during the Middle Uruk period. My last article was published in Georgia in 2006. The recent studies supported by new absolute dating are in favor of a high chronology for the Koro Araxes phenomenon, which in the opinion of Palumbi tends to stabilize between the mid-fourth and the mid-third millennia. Most recent discoveries from Areni Third Cave in the Vayat Zor region of southern Armenia put the bar even higher, demonstrating that the origin of the distinctive Koro Araxes cultural artifacts assemblage lies in the late Chalcolithic of the late 5th to early 4th millennia. In the opinion of the members of excavating team, Areni First can be placed in the patative hiatus between the late Chalcolithic Sioni and the fully developed Koro Araxes culture. But if we intend to date the starting point of the Koro Araxes culture, one of the first tasks should be the determination of the end of the preceding Chalcolithic culture of the Caucasus. To this period of time belong the still unsolved problem of interrelation between the Caucasian Chalcolithic and Uruk cultures. Well-known fact that South Mesopotamian merchants of the late period of the Middle Uruk and Late Uruk, hungry for same precious stones, timber, and metal ores, established a whole range of trading outposts along the routes going to the mountain of Zagros and Taurus and the Caucasus. Already in the middle of the 70s, Russian archaeologist Munchayev Andreeva proposed formation of the microculture of the northwestern Caucasus in consequence of the infiltration of the Near Eastern Mesopotamian groups of the population relating to the Amukev-Gaura cultural migration culture complex into the northern Caucasus. Nowadays, some archaeologists are connecting to the migration of the Uruk colonies not only the emergence of the Maikop culture, but as well and primarily of the Transcaucasian Chalcolithic culture, which afterwards have been spread from there into the northern Caucasus. Excuse me. If Uruk colonies as a rule are distinguishable from the indigenous settlements around them by a complex of material culture, pottery and other artifacts, architecture and graves, we have in the Caucasus quite different situation. More and more sites belonging to the culture of Leyla Tepe are detected every year in southern Transcaucasia, and therefore to speak only about some outposts of Uruk colonies becomes quite irrelevant. As it has been expected, some archaeologists already began to speak about the penetration of large masses of people of a quite new migrants for this region, bearers of Mesopotamian Uruk tradition in the middle of the fourth millennium, who settled down in every region of the Caucasus, in the mountains and flatlands, fundamentally changing the character of area and directing the economic and social development of the host society along a radically new and progressive path. In Transcaucasia, they have allegedly developed cultures of Leyla Tepe tradition. After they penetrated the North Caucasus, as well in large masses and rather intensively, and took participation in the creation of the Northern Caucasian microcultural tradition, covering the entire territory of the Caucasus. They considered that Uruk migrants had learned in the North how to build this type of burial mounds and brought the acquired tradition back to the South Caucasus. Rather complicated picture. New generation of archaeologists, unlike their predecessors, does not consider anymore the bearers of Ubaid culture as the founders of the so-called Leyla Tepe culture, but to Mesopotamian Uruk or Ubaid Uruk tradition migrated to Transcaucasia. In their opinion, the fact that the founders of culture Leyla Tepe were migrants from Mesopotamia now is without a doubt. But problem is a more precise definition of the time of this migration, by their opinion. The above mentioned concept, Ubaid Uruk, of course, means the time of Ubaid Uruk transition, the cultural period in North Mesopotamia during which Lloyd has seen the crucial indication of new era, unprecedented increase of metal objects. Recently, Maro, who had connected chef face wars collected in the Eastern Lake Pan district with Caucasian Chalcolithic pottery, and had related this to similar Amuk EF wars found south of the Taurus Mountains in North Mesopotamia, interpreted this resemblance as a sign of an intrusion of North Mesopotamian immigrants into the Caucasus prior to the well-known Uruk expansion to the north along the upper Euphrates. Lyonnais placed the Caucasus within the pre-Uruk expansion phenomenon. the nature of which, in her words, is still to be understood, and which now needs to be transported earlier, beginning of the Uruk period, and farther north, the Caucasus. The center and periphery explanation seems her far too simple solution, as influence were reciprocal and mutual, and more indicating on the equal relations between the two areas, each borrowing something from each other. The name of this period, Pre-Uruk, was quite logically created to distinguish it from the late Uruk expansion toward the upper Euphrates area, because the latter, as recently has become clear, can't be used to explain Mesopotamian-Caucasian connections even from pure chronological reasons. This is quite obvious. Late Uruk expansion is a reality of much later phenomenon than above mentioned Mesopotamian ties of Caucasian archaeological material. But such a dichotomy seems worthless. There is no real need to invent new terms to overcome a chronological discrepancy. Earlier, the term Ubaid expansion was replaced by the concept Uruk expansion to denote one and the same phenomenon, Mesopotamian ties of Caucasian cultures. Then it was thought that the wave of migrants from Mesopotamia to the Caucasus belonged to the representative of Ubaid culture, and this view was generally accepted. In the 80s of the last century, was already believed that so-called Leyla Tepe culture emerged as a result of the migration of the bearers of the Ubaid culture from Mesopotamia to Transcaucasia. So nowadays, this wave is determined as belonging to a later Uruk period when the Mesopotamian culture spread wider in the western and northeastern direction. The painted design of the Mughan Stepe pottery, Ali Kemek Tepesi, and so on, only imitates the 5th century millennium northern Ubaid painted tradition and is more roughly made and technologically inferior. Therefore, there is no need to explain their appearance to the southeastern Transcaucasia by the migration of the population with the Ubaid cultural tradition. Perhaps the explanation of this fact we can get by the remark of Stein that Ubaid type of culture has spread gradually outside of the core area and was selectively appropriated by the communities located there, who transformed and used the distinctive elements of above culture in ways that were fundamentally different from superficially similar sites with Ubaid culture in southern Mesopotamia. These local regional identities persisted in parallel with Ubaid identities, but seemed to have been expressed in different social and cultural contexts. Now, it is admitted that the Mesopotamians did not dominate the people of distant peripheries. Comparison of Uruk and local context show that peaceful interaction between them, which lasted for 300, 400 years, seems to have been in the form of symmetric economic and political relations rather than colonialist dominance. The recent discoveries made in northern Mesopotamia at Brak and Hamukar, added to those made long ago at Gaura, show that already in the beginning of the first millennium, the region was far more developed than expected. At the same time, a whole range of southern Transcaucasian sites, among them quite recently excavated, reveal signs of the Ubaid culture. In the second horizons of above mentioned cave Areni Fer, the pottery reveals the coexistence of sites of Areni cultural tradition with the sites of Leyla Tepe, Tehut, Perikl Debi group on the one hand, and the Tilki Tepe first near the Lake of Van. Some designs of the painted pottery of Areni reveal similarity with the material of the Mesopotamian type from Meshen Tepe in Azerbaijan. where recent research proved ties with Mesopotamian cultures during the terminal ubaid and the transitional phase to the late Chalcolithic, especially in its pottery. In Erkin, Gudazor, Volta River Canyon, and Sinjuk, large quantity of painted pottery of the ubaid culture has been recovered. Gudazor probably represents one of the northernmost settlements discovered so far, which indicates a clear northern ubaid related ceramic horizon. Its ceramic assemblage helps us to define more precisely the northern borders of an area culturally related to the ubaid developments taking place in southern and northern Mesopotamia. The site was possibly located on the edges of a region that was within the interaction sphere of the ubaid related communities of northwest Iran. To the north, that is, in the Lesser Caucasus and the Ararat Plain regions, the local communities were developing at a totally different and autonomous pace, Sioni complex. The fact that the archaeological material of Sioni Tsopi group of Georgia could be dated as synchronous with northern Ubaid period is proved by the finding of Sioni Tai pottery with comb patterns in Ali Kemek Tepe, together with northern Ubaid Tai pottery. At the same time, in the layers of Abd al-Aziz Tepe, the layers of Ilanli Tepe, Ali Kemek Tepe type were overlapped by the material characteristic for sites of Leyla Tepe group. Public Transcaucasian sites with import or imitation of Ubaid pottery are quite impossible to fit with the era of expansion of the Uruk culture outside its Mesopotamian homeland. We ought to take into account also the above-mentioned fact of discovery of Kurarax pottery of the advanced stage in the layers of the middle and late Uruk colonies along the upper Euphrates. This fact are obvious indication of the discrepancy of chronological character. It is timely remark made by Philip Cole that the well-known Uruk expansion has its predecessor, so it have left far less footprints for their presence in the Caucasus, and therefore no Habuba Kabira has been uncovered in the Caucasus region, and its discovery would be most unlikely. But who was this predecessor? That's the question. In my book published in 1981, I tried for the determination of the age of Tehut in the Ararat Valley, Armenia, and the sites of its circle to pay attention to the problem of origin of Gavra 11A cultural complex, which in my opinion had some trace typical for Tehut. Well-known fact that in Tepe Gavram the transformation or change from Ubaid to Uruk is very well visible. It was declared that a study of ceramic change in the Ubaid and Uruk periods of Mesopotamia illustrates how degeneration can be correlated with the development of complex societies in the region. Between the Ubaid and Uruk layers is visible, obvious, and sudden change in shapes and fabric become decidedly inferior shapes, crude, profiles irregular. Almost all distinctive late Ubaid forms disappear. In straight 11A, turnet used less often than in 12s. Painting ceased and no other ornamentation takes its place until painted pottery regains popularity in the latest Uruk Cemred Nas period. To put the idea straight, then I supposed, and maybe I still support this idea, that first of all the admixture of new population ought to be main reason of such a change in the culture. The archaeological material of Tepe Gavra 11A reveals some hereditary ties, so perhaps not a direct, with the material typical of Tehut. I would like to remind that by the old traditional viewpoint expressed by Tobler, Braidwoods, the Gavra 11A Amukev cultural complex belonged to the newcomers in northern Mesopotamia and the Amuk Valley. For example, some similarities can be observed between the pottery and figurines of Tepegrava 11A and Tegut. In regards to architecture, if rectangular houses were characteristic of Tepegrava 12, in the subsequent level, Gavra 11A, round houses appeared that are typical of the early farming communities of Trokkakhazia. It is interesting that the people of Tepegrava 12 and 11A used various types of copper ores. However, copper of the later level differs in the high content of arsenic. In connection with the problem of Mesopotamian Caucasian interrelations, especially actual and stimulating seem Lyonnais observation. Lyonnais emphasizes the importance the Caucasus area played in the formation of the Uruk culture in Mesopotamia. In the opinion of Lyonnais, to consider Transcaucasia only as a periphery providing raw materials does not fit well with what we know of its level of development, reached during the Neolithic and with the complexity of the burials and their wealth during the Chalcolithic. Some signs of metal productions. Even more, several innovations that appear at the time in Mesopotamia seem to have been borrowed from the Caucasus area because of their long tradition there, like the use of firing in a reduction atmosphere, the polishing on ceramic, the comb decoration, the so-called Canaan's blades, or the introduction of sheep breeding for the production of wool. Munchaev and Amirov recently proposed an idea about the shaping of the Halaf culture of Mesopotamia by the cultural influence coming from Transcaucasia. But only one thing we can say with certainty: the North was not a backward periphery of the South. Pisnell and Rossman, studying scrupulously the Tepegrava excavation report in the Fans of Pennsylvania Museum, and not only that, found reasons to challenge Algazes' above-mentioned theory and prove that economic specialization and political elaboration or complexity in the North were developing before intensified interaction with the South. The distance parity interaction model characteristic of the Uruk colonies better explains the organization and long-term effects of cultural contact between complex societies and less developed neighboring polities than the hegemony controlled by the core area as postulated in the alternative Algazes world system theory. The leveling effect of distance gives rise to highly variable social landscape in which the smaller, less complex polities of the periphery could indeed play an active role in structuring networks of interregional interaction. If it's increasing distance, it becomes difficult for Mesopotamians to dominate local communities, for example, in southeastern Anatolia and so on, and retaining economic autonomy in the Uruk enclaves there. It would have be even more difficult to retain such dominance in the Caucasus.
Thank you very much for this very general review and view of the interrelations between Mesopotamia and the Caucasus region. And I think this, again, we have the question for really precising the real contacts between Uruk, Obed, Uruk, and especially also, I would say, the early Bronze Age chronology, Eastern Anatolia with the Caucasus. I think we will have some questions, and so I open the discussion. But unfortunately, because of the light, I can't see. who
it's will possible to write because my hearing ability, I have terrible tinnitus. It's very poor last time. If it's possible to write down questions.
You mentioned that in Armenia some researchers think that
I will come down.
So you were mentioning that in Armenia some researchers think that Kuro Arax started already in the first half of the fourth millennium.
Yeah, but you mean Areni?
And I don't know. This I wanted to ask you who and on which basis.
Because of extrapolation. If we consider, for example, the date of Aslan Tepe 7. And we have already developed pottery, Kuro Arax pottery of developed stage. It must be understandable that earlier periods, I mean the Transcaucasian Kuro Arax by the traditional view, for example, Shida Kartli or Ararat Valley, they must be earlier than Aslan Tepe 7. But I am not quite sure, who knows, maybe this classical type of Kuro Arax has origin in Erzurum area. It's also possible.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions or remarks? Yeah, so I thank you very much for both the interesting paper.